Good evening. Welcome to the River Falls Municipal Utilities Advisory Board meeting for January 16th, 2017. Can we get a roll call?
Swanson. Richter.
Here.
Odine.
Here.
Macheski.
Here.
Toome.
Here.
Peterson.
Here.
And moving on to the approval of the minutes from the November 21st, 2016 meeting.
I move approval of the minutes.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
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 All opposed? Motion passes. Now is the time for any public comments. If anybody in the audience would like to speak. Yeah, no one? So we will move on to the consent agenda, which is item number one, the acknowledgement of the minutes of the West Central Wisconsin Biosolids Facility Commission and the Powerful Choices Committee meeting from November 10th and December 8th.
Move approval of consent agenda as published.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
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 All opposed? Motion passes. Item number two, be a resolution recommending electric line clearance tree and brush trimming contract.
I don't have a formal presentation on this tonight, Adam and board, but I will just say this, that our three-year contract has just expired for tree trimming, and we went out and we solicited bids, and we did get two bids in. And as you can see by the memo, Zeeley's Tree Service was the low bid overall, and we did some research on them and found out that they're going to be able to meet our needs well. Somebody might ask why we have a three-year contract for tree trimming, and I guess it boils down to the fact that we have our areas of town broken up into three areas, and they do one area every 3 years. So for 3 years, they get our complete town done. So that was partly the reason. Then secondly, I think it's just good every 3 years to go out to rebid for pricing. So anyway, we recommend that we approve Zeeley so they can get started in early February. Any questions?
Good evening,
Kevin.
It's nasty outside.
Yeah, it is.
Question, Kevin. Yeah. The hourly and everything is just everything is bid by the hour.
Mm-hmm.
How do we get to 120,000 and then stop?
Yeah, we do. We limit
to pay out the project and have them finish the project regardless of where the dollars end up.
Two things. Yes, I think we'll limit the purchase order to 60,000 for distribution, 60,000 for transmission. And the good news is, if you track back over the last 3 years, we usually spend a little bit less than that. So they've been coming in under the 60,000 in the previous 3 years. So we feel comfortable that the 60,000 is adequate to get it done. So, but we'll monitor that, and if they get close to it, they'll be letting us know. But okay. I don't foresee going over that.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Good evening, Kevin.
Hi. I have a question on this.
Yeah.
The contract, does the city attorney generally review the contracts?
We like to have our attorney review our contracts, yes.
Within the contract, the language, there's a mention of $1 million of insurance. Should there be a higher level for general liability?
And I know on that, so Julie works with our insurance companies. Do you have anything? I just think it's normal. Julie, you know better.
In general, we like contractors to match the city's insurance, but $1 million is absolutely the minimum. Higher would be good, and that can be a recommendation of the board, too. Yeah.
Okay, and another question would be subrogation, and maybe that's more of a question for an attorney, but should subrogation be part of that contract? That's a question, I guess.
I would have to look at it, and it would seem that it should be part of it, but I haven't looked at it in a week or so.
I didn't notice it in there, but and maybe
if that's
Member Odine would have more of a something to say about subrogation, but
well, I'm not acting as attorney to this body, but I know we're well represented by Council Dan Gustafson, and that's not frequently part of a contractor's contract language. So I'm willing to think that Mr. Gustafson reviewed this adequately. Also, you know, that subrogation would be if someone sued us for something they did, and I think
Correct.
Between their current insurance, they may have more insurance than they've stated, and our own insurance, I think the city would be adequately protected.
Okay. And I guess I just, that was more of questions to make sure that the city is covered.
Okay.
And again, the general liability, I'd be curious to know if that should be more than $1 million.
Well, I will May ask, I'll ask Dan if he feels comfortable with that. If not, then we could raise it too.
We have standard insurance language that we've gotten from our insurance company and our consultant for insurance. So we can just double check that and make sure that's adequate.
I do have a question though in that regard. Have we ever had any problem with any kind of a legal issue or harm that's been caused by brush or tree trimming?
Not since I've been here. We have not had a legal issue.
Okay.
We've had some disagreement on which tree to take out, but we have not had any.
But it's never fallen on anyone,
no,
right?
No, it has not. Okay. Not since I've been here, no.
Okay, thank you.
Perfect. Any more discussion at all? Looking for a motion to approve resolution number 2017-01, resolution approving vegetation management and right-of-way clearing.
So moved.
Any discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed, same sign. Resolution passes. Item number 3 in the packet is the resolution recommending changes to business incentive program, and I believe Mike Noreen is going to speak to that.
I am. Good evening, everybody. So tonight, The resolution is the changes to the incentive program for energy efficiency, and we'll get right to it. With powerful choices and utilities, there's a program, a tool that utilities have. Oh, yes. I got ahead of myself, sorry. All right, for those people watching at home, there's the front page. And then powerful choices. Utilities, there's a couple different ways that you can satisfy the needs of a customer for their power usage. In the middle of the day, sometimes in the middle of the year, the summer, the speed of which energy is used, the demand, in order to meet that need, we can bring on more power. That power is often very expensive. And utilities generally do not profit from that, even if you're a nonprofit utility. So the majority of electric utilities use a program called demand-side management, which we do, and that's where we encourage the customer to be more efficient through putting in new efficient equipment, through education and incentives. And that's called demand-side management, and that's kind of what we're going to be talking about today. Like I said, this is a common way that utilities reach their goals, and it's cost-effective. What we use at River Falls Utilities, and I would say about 75% of the utilities in Wisconsin utilize Focus on Energy, the statewide program for energy efficiency, renewable energy, and incentives. We pay into it, and then we have to work to get the money back to our community. In the time that Focus on Energy has been around, eligibility for lighting or whatever it might be for the products, that's changed quite a bit, and incentive levels have changed. Whereas in years past, you might get $10 for a new efficient light fixture. Now it's creeping lower and lower. So in order to kind of offset that and to encourage the usage of Focus on Energy, powerful choices instill the match of that incentive. So that $5 for the light fixture, we also give you $5 for that light fixture, and it drives projects, excuse me. We have a cap of $5,000 per project and 75% of the overall project cost. What we're proposing to change is, instead of giving that match in terms of cash, we would give it in terms of community solar. So if you have a large project and you're getting $500 back from Focus on Energy, our match would be a community solar share. That way, that customer is getting on their electric utility bill a credit on their monthly bill for the next, in this case, about 18 and a half years. We're also proposing to increase the cap from $5,000 to $10,000. That would be more attractive to some of the bigger projects that we have going on, and we do have a lot of new economic development in River Falls that we're using to, again, bring in some of those businesses to River Falls and make them efficient right off the bat. Just to give you a little background, in 2015, the matching funds that we went out was about $18,000. There's some other incentives that were smaller, but if you're getting an incentive for $300 or $50 or something like that, then that would be still a cash incentive. But if it gets up to that $500 range, then it's community solar. In 2016, we're at about $22,000. And that's the approximate shares that would come out of it.
How many projects were part of this match in 2015 and 2016?
It worked out to, I don't have that number cemented in my head, but it worked out to probably around between 15 and 25.
Okay.
There was a couple. There were $5,000 matches, Minnesota Rubber and NCCM.
Okay. So about how big is your typical match?
Typical is probably around 2,000.
Okay. Thanks.
Mm-hmm. Is there anything I can answer for you?
Question. Is this a way of bailing out the solar program?
Nope. I think we have some panels we could still sell yet, and just a way to sell some more. So no, I don't bailing out, I don't think is the right term, but we have at the hospital, after they commit, which I think they're going to do, we'll have about 200 to 250 to sell yet. And we have a couple options. One, we can wait for about three more developments in town where we can attach 90 shares to incoming new development into the TIF, like we've done the last three. That would get us about there. Or we can try to continue to sell them along the way through this way. And we think this is another good way to sell the last couple hundred shares.
Yeah, I actually would think that having these businesses that participate in the community solar would be a whole lot better than giving them just a cash incentive. Mm-hmm.
Actually, I was going to make that point. I think this kind of gives twice, right? So let's say you get one panel. So you get a $500 panel with value, but then that keeps giving over the next 18 and a half, 19 years as well. You're getting money back. So you get the $500 panel plus about $500 worth of electricity over 18 and a half, 19 years.
Mr. Peterson, that's a fair question. But what I like to look at is when you have community solar, then you're more of an ally with the utilities. You have a close relationship, and that's what we're trying to do. Is we are trying to be an ally, and then you know it's a ongoing positive thing. As you get that the credit, you are part of the like kind of the Powerful Choices mission that we're trying to accomplish. So I think there's a lot of positives to having people have community solar.
Seems to me that the customer that's qualifying for this would be more interested in getting a check than getting a letter stating they've got 12 solar panels that you can expect to get your money back in 15 years.
That's right. Yeah, potentially. Potentially. I mean, yeah, that's, yeah. So you would have the cash. So you're still going to get the cash from Focus on Energy, and then our match, which is a relatively new program, right? The match?
Yep.
So we've been matching for a couple of years?
Yep.
So the match would be the solar, but they would still get the cash from Focus. So there still would be some cash coming back, Dwayne, but it's part of the kickback would be in solar. But yeah, you're probably, someone would probably want the cash.
Nonetheless, part of it is a letter that you get 15 panels and you're going to get your money back in 15 years.
Over time, yeah. Yes, yeah. So that's a fair statement. Yeah, somebody might say, no, I'd rather have the check. Then the answer would be, we policymakers decided to reward in solar panel, which has value. There is value in that, or rather than the cash for the match incentive portion. But that's a fair comment.
Yeah, and they'll know well in advance that, I mean, before they get into it, that this is the program. So it's not through our customer service. It is when we're out talking to people, trying to, you know, help them out in their efficiency needs. This is something they will know before they start that program, before they start the project.
Mike, I have a couple questions. I'm sorry, I always have questions. Does Focus on Energy have a cap today? What is their cap?
Their cap is 60% of the project cost. So if you have a project that is very large, like the Falcon Center, there's two different ways you can go. You can get a prescriptive, like I get $5 per light, or if you have some newfangled light that they need to figure out themselves, they will tell you in advance, like, okay, yeah, this is a qualified light. We'll give you $7.50 for it. So the caps are different for those two different kinds. So with a regular prescriptive one, a prescriptive program, if you want to put lights in, there's a cap, I believe, of $25,000. And for the custom incentive, I'm not aware of a cap.
Okay. And this, to his point, somebody looking through a big investment and trying to get some money back, looking at that long term to try to get that money back, this is more of a stewardship kind of a thing. Is that true?
Well, it's, you know, it is an investment. There is a payback on it. You are getting your money back over the course of years. Is it would you invest in it to make a lot of money? Probably not. But it's not just a altruistic program. It is an investment with a payback.
And there is real value. I mean, there is value. You might not like the cash value better than the solar panel value, but there is that value in it. And actually, the value is twice what the cash is, because you get the panel and over time you get the money. So.
Any consideration given to giving the potential customer the option? You can either get a check or you can get 15 panels.
Right. We haven't discussed that. Mike kind of said we should go with the solar, and I agreed with him on that. But that's something for you folks to decide. I mean, it's up to you.
Well, yeah. I mean, you mentioned that you've raised it from 5,000 to 10,000, the limit.
Yes, that's what we're proposing.
Proposing, you know, so I mean, I suppose you could take 5,000 in cash or 10,000 in solar panels. And I mean, I do understand that sometimes, if it's a really, economics of your project are really close, that's the whole driving point is to get the upfront money so that you can go pursue your project and your project is going to save you money over time, which is the same thing as the solar panels are going to do. But if you just can't convince the boss that it's worth the investment without that extra little bit of money, you'd hate to not have a project go just because of that. So probably pretty unlikely, but could happen.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this is, I mean, too, this is our, you know, Mike's idea, and I support the idea, but if you think we should go a different direction or have different input, I mean, that's why we bring it to you. So that for, I mean, we have this representative municipal electric utility, and you folks are the eyes and ears of our customers, and we're here to listen, so.
Both the focus on energy from the state and our local match are, you know, essentially using ratepayer dollars to change social behavior. Essentially a public expense, and it's an investment that our community has felt really strongly about is renewable energy, and in particular now solar. So I think this is a great way to encourage the businesses that we partner with to participate with us in that going forward. So I approve of this. The panels are something I assume that there would be some shift from, Julie, from the fund that we usually use for this through the solar panels that the city already has. Mm-hmm. Correct. So, no, I think this is I think it's good on both sides. And I would hope that that the businesses we partner with who are interested in doing something that's renewable or use less energy would feel that way as well.
I'm concerned about incentivizing. I mean, personally, I love it when something costs an exact amount and it's predictable and simple. I know that's not the world we live in. I was at Kohl's over Christmas. I get it. At the same time, and I'm very much in favor of many of the projects that have come through. There's a lot of positive here. I'm specifically concerned about the solar. I thought about trying to track down where federal money comes in to incentivize things, and I thought, you know, this project specifically, maybe I could find it. But I really just went to straight up cost benefit on solar, and it's about a wash in most of this part of the country. Over 20 years, you'll get your money back if a tree doesn't fall on it, kind of a thing. And that's fine. And a lot of people, especially in this community, are in favor of that. And that's fine. My concern is the incentive side of that. I mean, we're a utility, and we're making a choice. Solar will get there. There's no doubt in my mind a few years from now it's going to be cool. Technology's improving and so on and so forth. But I see this particular project as maybe a little early is the way I would put it. Not bad. As a community that looks at this type of project and maybe is in favor of it, maybe we're not early. Maybe that's just my own personal take. But that's my personal take, is we're a little early on the solar, and I hesitate to incentivize it for that reason. So I intend to vote no for this, but I'd love to see these items separated because I really do like the projects. That's where I stand, and you're more than welcome to respond to that if I'm missing something.
We need a second to her motion.
Did you make a motion?
No, I didn't.
I'm sorry.
But if I may speak to that, I do know that participation in the solar garden is now a regular part of TIF financing and developers agreements that the city council uses with developers, and we've gotten some excellent response from that. They're usually happy that is part of it.
Sure.
So this kind of parallels in a project scale what we're doing on a development scale.
Yep, and this is not, while the using the incentives instead of cash for community solar, mm-hmm. That part is unique and new. The idea of utilities providing incentives, it is, you'd probably be hard-pressed to find a utility that doesn't use demand-side management
sure.
as a tool. So incentives are very commonplace.
And I understand that very well.
Okay.
It's you know, and I understand it could be wind turbines or solar, or in our case, hydro. I mean, we can do that here in a variety of ways. I'm stuck on solar, and I'm not mad about it. I'm not even trying to create any kind of argument. I'm concerned about incentivizing something that maybe should be done later So, and we have it. I'm not asking that we take it down. You know, that's that would be unreasonable. So, but yeah. And I, is it possible to take part of this resolution, the project side of it, and leave the shares alone for the time being? If that's on, you know, if not, I don't know. Do you know what I'm saying there?
That you would, you'd like the cap?
The $5,000 to $10,000 for projects.
Okay.
Is that, how is that connected to the solar? Or is it?
So yeah, we're already doing the $5,000 match.
Right.
So yeah, and that's outside of this resolution. This resolution's about, instead of cash, you get it in solar. So
okay.
So we're already doing the $5,000 match incentive in cash. And now we're just asking the UAB, instead of cash, can we do it in solar panels?
Right.
Instead.
But you're also right. It is also increasing that cap from five to ten.
So certainly you could say we agree with increasing the cap. We don't agree with providing the solar panels.
And that's what, and I'm just asking
up
that
to the board.
So.
Mm-hmm. And I just want to validate Duane again too. You know, selling out. I mean, this is a creative way. We have a couple hundred panels left to sell. We're probably not going to have people, 200 more people, local residents knocking at our door to buy ones and twos. Mm-hmm. I mean, we might over time, but this is a way to accelerate that and sell the last couple hundred panels. And we thought there was enough value in the panel and then the payback that it would equate. But you know, people might want the cash, but it still has value. So you're right.
Problem with offering that as an option to any one of the people, but I want to give them a choice. Mm-hmm. If they choose the cash route, then they get it. If they choose the panels, that's fine. I don't think it's, you stated that we're using ratepayer dollars to influence attitude to solar. I don't think that's, we aren't giving them an opportunity. We're forcing them to that.
And that's
that
is, fair.
In my opinion, I don't think that's right.
I think that's a good point.
I disagree. They don't have to do these programs at all.
Well, exactly. And if they don't do these programs at all, then the whole program, we could just, well, scrap it. Because that's what will happen. We'll discourage people from using this program.
Well, I've got a proposed amendment, but first I'll move, in order to discuss the proposed amendment, first I'll move that we approve resolution number 2017-02, authorizing changes to business incentive program. If I can get a second to it, I can talk about an amendment. Oh, thank you. Okay, I would propose an amendment and I will let you, Mike, and staff do the language and the whereases, but that we offer participants a choice, whether solar or cash, up to $5,000.
So it would be $5,000 in cash and then $5,000 in solar?
If it was a $10,000 project. If it was below $5,000, you could choose it to be all cash. But if it was one of these bigger ones that we currently aren't doing, it would be over five. They could get $5,000 in cash, but over that, it would potentially be. I mean, if it was up to 500 solar.
Which is basically right now, it's. The 5,000 is the cap,
right?
And as part of this, we were doubling that,
right?
And so the double part of it,
right? So essentially, everybody who's eligible for it now under the current rate, under our current scheme, under this one, would have a choice between cash or solar. The people who have the bigger projects that we currently do not match would be solar. Would get a solar panel instead of the cash for the amount over $5,000, if that's what they chose.
Then can we vote on this?
If I've got a second for it.
Second. Or I can't second, can I?
Yeah, you can.
I just second it. Perfect. So we'll Vote on resolution 2017-02, resolution authorizing changes.
Wait, first on the amendment.
You have to vote on the amendment first.
Oh, sorry. Voting on Diane's amendment to resolution 2017-02. All in favor say aye.
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 All opposed? Amendment passes. Now I'm looking for a motion on resolution 2017-02, the resolution authorizing changes to the business incentive program. So we're good.
We've already made a motion and a second for that, so okay. You just need to vote on it.
So voting on resolution 2017-02, all in favor say aye.
No question.
Is
the amendment clear, or does that have to be properly prepared and then voted on perhaps at the next meeting?
What I would do is play back the tape and then take Diane's verbiage
and just put it in there.
Verbatim on that.
I think we understand the intent.
Yeah. I understand the intent right now. Okay. I couldn't say back exactly what Diane said, but I understand the intent. And when I play back the tape of tonight, I'll be able to see exactly what she said and get that in the whereas in the resolution. So up to 5,000, well, let me restate it so I understand. So up to the first 5,000 match, customers would have a choice whether or not to take the cash or the solar. If you fall in that bracket between the 5,000 and 10,000, that would be in solar.
Correct.
A larger customer. But, and I would say, just to your amendment, 90 to 95% of the people utilizing this program will fall under the 5,000 and under. We'll only have one or two that go above five.
I suspect many of them might choose solar.
You suspect what?
I suspect many of them might choose a solar panel if given the choice.
We're going to find out.
But now they'll have a choice.
That's the case, yes.
But I would be more comfortable if we took another voice vote on that, since it kind of got interrupted.
Sure. Looking for a voice vote on the motion to approve resolution 2017-02 with the amendment, resolution authorizing changes to business incentive program. All in favor say aye.
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 All opposed? The resolution passes with the amendment.
I just want to just comment, say that that's a very healthy discussion and a great compromise. Thank you. That was good. Thanks, Dwayne.
Yep.
Thanks, Diane.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Mike. Moving on to item number four is the finance report, and Julie can speak to that.
You have in front of you, hopefully, the very, very preliminary December report for electric, water, sewer, stormwater. It's just some highlights, I guess I would call it, of the electric fund. You can see it's under budget by $1.2 million, and that's due to reduced costs from purchase power. So Kevin probably knows the real reason behind that, but I know they didn't bill us as much as they have in the past. Yeah, so therefore, we didn't bill the customers as much.
Yeah, just a temperate year, mm-hmm. and power prices were down. So
yep.
gas was cheap. And
that was great. A couple other comments. You can see the cash balances. I wanted to point that out. Electric and the wastewater fund are quite high, and just a reminder that we may want to pay cash for the power plant substation and then any costs that are coming up about the north interceptor and sewer. So that's why those are sitting there. You might say, why we have all this money. Decisions on that can be made once we know the costs, the final costs of the north interceptor for sure. That one's still a little iffy at this point. So more to come on that, but right now we are going to maintain those balances until we know more about those projects. And I can answer any questions you might have.
Okay, moving on to item number five, the utility dashboards that are all in your packets. Does anybody have any questions on those?
Do we have a fiscal year starting in a particular month?
January?
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yep, for calendar year.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions on that? Moving on to item number six, the monthly utility report.
Uh,
I'd like to just give one addition to the electric. It's what many of you are already aware of, but you may have some questions around it. But late last Thursday night, 11:45 p.m., then into early Friday morning, we had a relay, electronic relay, go out at our South Fork substation, and we had about almost 1,800 of our customers out of power for just under 2 hours on a very cold night. So I was in Wayne Cyberling's office this afternoon, and the old one I saw, the new one's been installed, but the old one's sitting in a box, and we're sending it in for repairs, and that'll be a backup when it comes back. So just a simple piece of electronic equipment, and what's unusual is it was scheduled to be replaced about 2.5 weeks from now. So it didn't quite make it. Interesting enough.
Was this failure weather related at all? It was a really cold night.
Nope, it was not weather related, just electronic failure. And when it failed, it opened up, they think, about two metal blades into the switches. It opened them up, boom, and knocked that whole substation out of power. So you go to the substation, you see the blades open, and the first thing you think is, oh my, the transformer malfunctioned or blew up or burned out, which had been really catastrophic. Mm-hmm. That was about a $2 million investment, but it was just the relay. So, but they discovered it, then they send the guys out, they have to go to the different switching points, and they got everybody switched to power plant substation. So that's what, discovery of the problem, and then going out and doing the manual switching. I think we did it in 3 or 4 different segments, so people were on at like 1 hour and 45 minutes, 1 hour and 50, and 1 hour and 55, roughly. Anyway, it's electric systems, so they look really sophisticated. A lot of it's pretty just basic wires and functioning mechanical pieces. And sometimes this can be vulnerable, but we do what we can to maintain it and then fix it when it breaks. So.
Any other questions at all? Perfect. We'll move on to announcements.
Kevin, I've got a couple things. So next month on our February 20th meeting, we're going to be doing 3 things that day. One, at 5:00, we're going to be offering an open house at our new wastewater treatment facility. And Dwayne will be in Florida, so you're going to miss that. Envy you. But we're going to open that up at 5:00. So from 5:00 to 6:00. You can come down and check out the new $4 million facility that y'all approved and were part of. It's a pretty neat facility, and we're already seeing really good results as far as how thick we're getting the sludge. I think we're going to be able to reduce our hauling to Ellsworth, almost cut it in half next year. So that'll be significant savings, even more than we anticipated. Electricity will be also saved there, and much safer, cleaner, should be less odor. I hope you can come down at 5:00 next week. So then we're going to come back here at 6:00, and we'll serve a light dinner. We'll have some sandwiches or something at 6:00. Then at 6:15 to 7:00, we're going to have a combined with council work session, and we want to show you our assessment of our water system. So we're doing a water system assessment, kind of like we did with sewer, and rate our system from 1 to 5. We're going to kind of give you an overview of where we think our water system's at and where our priorities are. And that'll be about a 45-minute work session. Then we'll start this meeting at about 7:00 instead of 6:30. So we'll have 5:00 tour, 6:00 dinner, 6:15 work session. And it'll be, and then those first 2 items will be combined with city council.
Maybe I'll cancel my trip.
If you want the tour, you can get that anytime you come back. Yeah, we'll have announcements on that as well.
Kevin, what was the date of that again?
I think it was February 20th. Am I correct? Correct?
February 20th. Okay. 20th.
February
Thank you.
20th.
Thank you. And I assume the public's invited to the tour if
they're... Sure, yep. We'll invite the public to the work sessions as well.
Anything else?
I think that's it. I was going to mention what we're going to go over next month, too. We're going to have a little presentation. Some of our rates for our larger customers are changing they're changing seasonally. And I want to introduce you to that next meeting as well. During our meeting, Wes Arndt will give a little presentation on some rate changes for our from our wholesale provider that we've been passing along. So now our rates aren't changing internally, but our wholesale provider's rates are changing to us. So, but I'll share that with you next month.
And I've,
Kenny Quarter Planning Session, January 26th, 6:30, 8 o'clock at the library, our first tech talk. So 6:30 to 8 o'clock on January 26th, I think that's a Thursday. Come on out.
Perfect. And to add that, coming up on February 16th, there's the Kenny Corridor Project Committee meeting. We're going to be discussing, the theme will be the vision and the mission of that. And then just one other one, Tech Talk number 2, which will be on March 9th. That'll also be at the library in the lower level. And that one, the tentative theme will be river ecology. So we will update those. And you can always go to the Facebook page and the River Falls city page / Kenny Corridor for information on that. Perfect. Any other announcements?
Yeah, no, I'm just saying some of these tech talks may say, what's a tech talk? Well, here's what they're going to talk about. Like, what is a corridor plan? What sorts of things will be examined and analyzed? How will my ideas and concerns be addressed? How will the Kenny Corridor plan be used? So we'll have experts talking about those type of things and taking questions and answers. So
I just have a question on the amendment, just a clarification thing. If I was a customer and I was below the 5,000 range, will I have the option of taking either a solar panel or a check?
Yes,
yes.
That was,
is that
yes,
what your intent
yes,
was?
Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
Just wanted to make
yep.
that clear.
So you both kind of got what you wanted. You have the option that's in there?
Yeah, that's
fine. And then
fine.
If you go above 5,000, though, you're going to get the solar.
Yeah, I have no problem with that, as long as they have the choice.
They'll have the choice.
Yep.
That's very good. Thanks, Dwayne. I appreciate that.
Can I ask a question about the solar, since we talked so much about the solar? Back, and I don't know, Julie, maybe you can help me understand. A few meetings back, we talked about there was the city was trying to decide if they're going to buy the panels or not buy them, and it was going back and forth. And can you refresh, how did it happen that we bought them? Did it go through the city council? Did it go through the board?
City council approved that.
Council approved it, okay.
And the panels are an asset. They're an asset on the books. We're receiving credits every month for the electricity, so it's not a negative. There's some thought that we should, you know, get rid of them as soon as we can, but they're, in my opinion, they're fine to have on the books, but, you know, if people want them, we definitely would sell them, so.
Yeah, no, I didn't mean it as a negative. I was just
trying
to
understand.
No,
I know you didn't, but.
Because generally that would go through this board before it'd go to the council, wouldn't it, or wouldn't it?
We talked about it.
We talked about it, but we never voted, I don't believe, unless.
I would say it's not so much a function of the utility board because we still had the panels. I mean, I guess I didn't see it too closely tied to the utility.
Or a financial transaction than a utility transaction.
If we were selling it to another utility, that would be something that you would want to vote on.
I was just trying to understand the process, I guess.
Uh-huh.
That
mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you.
Any other discussion or announcements? Motion
I would say be safe because it is very icy out there. Be safe.
Especially when you get on the landing order before you hit the parking lot.
Yep.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Great. We're adjourned.